here in Detroit, John O'Hurley. I'm just disappointed you didn't bring your golf club.
Oh, we just talked about that. Yes, yes. No, when I'm on the road, I've got too many things to do, and golf is unfortunately not one of them.
So I'm going to tell you the risk upsetting you here. A few years back, the show Chicago was in town, and it had as one of its stars B.B. Newworth. And we interviewed B.B. on the show. I made the mistake of telling her that I had really enjoyed, I hadn't seen the stage version, that I had really enjoyed the movie version. She went ballistic. She went absolutely nuts on me. And then after she left, she actually called back and was cursing us out.
Really?
Yeah, having the temerity to even bring up the movie.
I can't believe that.
Is that bad?
Well, no, that's her.
That's me.
I think I thought the movie was fabulous, and it's very difficult to actually do an adequate representation of a musical on film. They're very difficult to do, and I thought they did a great job of it.
And now that's how I thought she would react to that.
I also think it helped the Broadway show a great deal. We had a surge right after the movie came out.
Really?
Yeah.
How long have you been with the Broadway show?
Gosh, it was right after Dancing with the Stars that I went over to Broadway, so that was in 2005, I think.
So you were doing
that? And then I did it for about 4 or 5 months on Broadway, then I took it out on tour for a while. I went over to Spamalot and did that for several years.
Right.
Came back to Chicago and Broadway, and then went out on tour again with it as well. So I like to go back and forth with the show. To me, it's like an arrow in the quiver you just throw across the bow.
Now, how did you fit Family Feud into all of that?
Well, very difficult. I was host for 4 years, and it really did restrict everything I did. But we would shoot it in strip there. Basically, we would do 12 shows on a weekend. And 14 weekends a year. So it was really difficult. And there were some times when I was doing Spamalot there at the Amundsen Theater in L.A. when I would shoot 12 shows, or I would shoot 6 shows a day, and then go do the show for 2.5 hours at night at theater, and then go back and do the same thing all over again. It was some of the most stressful and tiring times of my life, because I never come off, in Spamalot, I never came off the stage. Mm-hmm.
John O'Hurley, when I talk to performers like you, generally they love the stage so much that I can't even picture a connection between somebody who is so, if you will, addicted to performing before a live audience and someone who would do a game show like that. What was the draw in doing that?
Well, the game show's a lot of fun, because remember, we shoot it live to tape. There are no breaks. We take a break, obviously, to move the set around, but everything is done live, no editing. And it's not scripted, and that's what I like about it. And so you know the show has to be entertaining and it has to be funny. And when you begin the show, you walk out and you have to leap and hope the net will appear. Because you have no writers, you have nothing. You just have to hope that what you're going to say and the audience or the people that are playing the game will be entertaining enough. And it's a thrill for that. I really enjoy it.
I saw some of the YouTube clips of the greatest moments while you were hosting. You're right. They were clearly unscripted. I mean, there were some fun times. You've got to be light on your feet. It's almost like you're a stand-up comic.
In a bit, yeah. But it's an improvisational comic is what you really need to be. One of my favorite moments on the show is when someone walks up to the face-off, and I said, name a classic film that begins with the letter C. And you would say, Casablanca, there's so many of them.
Chicago.
Well, that's right, thank you. He hits the buzzer and says, Seabiscuit.
Oh, my goodness. That's like a good joke.
It is.
So many of those. So, obviously, you get those opportunities based on Seinfeld and the appearance there?
How much did
Seinfeld help you?
Enormously. It was and still is the number one show on television, and number one show in 85 countries. Yeah, it helps you a lot.
Well, the character got you a company.
Yes, I did buy the company, oddly enough, back in 99, the year after Seinfeld ended. The real J. Peterman company went bankrupt, and I bought it, and he and I own it together now.
Is that right?
True story.
Are you selling Urban Sombrero?
No, we did leave those out of the out of the menu. But if you go to jpeterman.com, you'll see the catalog that we parodied on Seinfeld. Same old pastel drawings with long drawn out adventure stories like Hemingway about an Oxford button down.
Who would have thought it? You know, only in America can you be a figure on a comedy series and wind up owning a company.
That you did as the parody. It's the greatest act of identity theft, and frankly, I'm not giving it back either.
I want to tell you something. In preparing for this interview this morning and to speak with you, I went back and I read your commencement address at Providence College, your alma mater back in 06. And I was so impressed with what you talked about to those kids. And I think, again, to Villanova School of Business a few years later when mm-hmm. you gave that commencement address. And you talked about young people seeking the extraordinary life, something mm-hmm. that you've always tried to do based on the advice you got from an elderly gentleman. Mm-hmm. I hope you'll share that with our audience.
Well, thank you for that. It's very nice of you to have gone that deep and find that something that meaningful. Yes, but back in 1991, the gentleman grabbed my arm when I asked him what it was that made him the success that he was. And he reached over, grabbed my arm, and a little twinkle in his eyes. He says, John, you have two choices in life. You can have an ordinary life, or you can have an extraordinary life. And that's it. And it has nothing to do with money, and it has nothing to do with power, but it has everything to do with the power and the richness of your choices. And I thought of that, and I thought about it probably every day ever since, and I've reflected on it, I've written about it, I've written two bestsellers on it, I speak to companies all across the country, I speak to colleges, and just on the concept, I call it now the Peterman Guide to the Extraordinary Life. And as I see it, I've isolated three elements of the extraordinary life. One is, the first is imagination and valuing what you imagine. Because if you do not value what you imagine, you're taking a step towards an ordinary life. And it's as simple and brutal as that. And the second thing is contemplation, and that's stillness. You need stillness so you can appreciate the little moments that are going on all around us. We distract ourselves from distraction by distraction, as T.S. Eliot used to say. Third element is appreciation. And learning to give back, and that the measure of your life really is on your ability to give back. And those are the three elements of the extraordinary life.
To give back or to give, though? To give back would seem to suggest that you've taken something from somebody.
Well, I think you've been given so many things. I think life has given us many, many things. And I think giving back is an appropriate way.
And don't be afraid to leap, the net will appear. Huh?
You leap, and the net will
appear. I mentioned that earlier.
It is. It's really because the next step in your life is never a step away. It's always a leap away. The next thing you should be doing is never a step away.
When we look at your life, though, your professional life, mm-hmm. it looks as if there was never a time when you had to leap. It looks as if one step simply followed another.
Oh, no, I've had to take enormous leaps in my life. In fact, I resigned from the head of public relations for the American Red Cross to go to New York, and I only had $800 in my pocket. And I lived in a $80 a week single-room occupancy hotel. Yeah, I know. I've taken enormous leaps in my life.
You took a chance because you wanted something more.
My dream, my vision, my sense of who I was an actor, not as a public relations man. And although I have great admiration for those in the public relations business, and I don't mean to cut that down.
We have several in the studio.
But it wasn't correct for me, and I knew it. And so I had to take an enormous leap in my life.
And then, speaking of leaps, Dancing with the Stars.
That was probably the biggest leap. That was the biggest leap.
You were on the first season.
I won the first season, ultimately. Yes, I was the guy. And that's God's great practical joke, because I thought they told me, yes, you'll just go on, rehearse for 3-4 hours a week, and you know, do it as long as you can until you're voted off or whatever. And I said, well, I'll be the first one off. That's okay. And I got into it, and I started going. Well, not 3 or 4 hours a week. It was 7 hours a day, 7 days a week, and the first time I went out on stage and did the cha-cha, I realized I wasn't that bad. And darn it, maybe we could win this thing. And
were you then, a dancer going
no, in? No, I was the guy with a glass of Chardonnay at the wedding reception, standing against the wall saying, knock yourselves out, Shriners. I was not the guy on the dance floor. And but I tell you, I learned a great deal, if you want to talk about leaping and the net will appear, that really was. Every week that I went out on that stage, I had no idea what was going to happen. I mean, I was just flying by the grace of God, and I was lucky enough to have a great coach and choreographer and Charlotta Jorgensen there, and we ended up winning, ultimately.
Well, Kelly Monaco from the
soap opera
was originally the winner, and then they had a dance-off.
Then they had the controversial dance-off, well,
because they thought it was rigged. Everybody thought it was rigged that she won.
Well, in a way it was, because the only way you could vote was online at ABC, but in order to get online, you had to register, so she already had 2 million people or whatever it was there on on ABC because of the show, because of her show. So she, and they were voting all along, so she would never lose. And then they had no live voting, so they had to institute live voting. So it forced them. When they got this, when ABC was given Dancing with the Stars, it was a summer replacement, so they weren't going to put a lot of money into figuring it out. And all of a sudden, lo and behold, the first show goes up that one night, and 20 million people watched, 30 million watched the next week, and they all of a sudden had the big hit, yes. Yeah. That was, they didn't see that coming at all.
Well, you've got a hit on your hands with Chicago at the Fisher Theater, and what do you like about this show?
Well, it's on my list of the five great musicals ever done on Broadway.
What are the others?
The Les Mis, Man of La Mancha, Phantom of the Opera. I love Cats. I think Cats is one of the great shows ever done as well. And I think in Chicago as well. There are some others as well, but if I had five to name, that would be right off the top. It's got some of the best music, that's certainly the best choreography, and I think the book is a piece of magic, and it's a joy to go out there and just participate in this piece of jazz every night, and that's exactly what it is. It, whether you're speaking or whether you're singing or whether you're dancing, it's a piece of jazz, and this whole show works together like that. You can't separate the words from the music, from the dialogue, from the choreography.
Starring our guest, John O'Hurley, an extraordinary performer living an extraordinary life in an extraordinary show downstairs. Great.